And all the glory does belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Happy Independence Day. And we're still celebrating this morning. And, you know, our country is not perfect. But we have much, much, much to be thankful for. And we are still free. And we praise the Lord for all that have sacrificed so that we could have freedom even this morning. And so let's ask the Lord to meet with us in a special way on this special day. Lord, we're thankful for what you've done in the past in our country. Lord, we do pray for our country. We love our country and many difficult things happening. But Lord, we are so grateful that we are still free. We're so thankful that we still live in America. We're so thankful that because of those who have fought before us, before this day, that we could come to church this morning. And we don't have to worry about our freedom being in question. And Lord, thank you for an opportunity that we have to worship you, to serve you by singing this morning, to serve you by giving, by listening, by responding to the message. And Lord, we want to honor you. Lord, please, would you help us not to just go through the motions and play church this morning? Help us to be actively engaged in our minds, to be focused on you, that you would be pleased with everything that is said, everything that's done. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you. our national anthem. It isn't, but it's a great song. Sing it, you'll feel it. I was born in America, but I never sang it in America.
Thank you all for being here today, and we have many, many guests, and I think most of them are from the same family. Y'all didn't know this was Ham Sunday, and so Mrs. Ham, would you introduce all of these people that are here with you today? Money or a vehicle or things like that. That today, I don't know what it is about the Lucas family having birthdays on the actual Sunday that we announce it, but Grant Lucas, happy birthday. And you are how old? 17 today, this very day. So happy birthday to you. And then Mia has a birthday tomorrow, right, Mia? Trying to hide back there. Happy birthday, Mia. And anniversaries or birthdays, did I miss anybody that's going to happen this very week? Anybody?
One of my granddaughters, Kayla, is a firecracker baby, and yesterday was her birthday.
Well, happy birthday, Kayla. And what'd I say?
She's 10.
She's 10. Yes, happy birthday. All right, just a few announcements. Chase for Victory will continue this Wednesday. Drew Pelletier's done a fantastic job. I hope you've been able to listen to it. Victory over hurt is the topic on Wednesday night. And he's preached to us two Wednesdays in a row. He'll finish it up this Wednesday, and I hope you can be there, be here for that. And then lunch and discipleship next week, that will continue. Hope you can be here this afternoon. We're going through the book of Proverbs, and we're picking out peculiar proverbs. Today, we'll be looking at the Proverbs that says, even in laughter, the heart is sorrowful. And maybe that's a little bit strange to you. We're going to be looking at what that might mean and how we can apply that to our lives. A date that you really need to know, and I'm so excited about it, and I'm afraid to even announce it because I'm afraid that people are going to get so excited that they'll stand up and start screaming in church, and we'll have to calm everybody down. But I'm just going to go ahead and announce it, all right? Not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday for Chase for Victory, it is Parents' Night. And that means whoever brings their, I knew it was going to be exciting, and I need y'all to calm down. That means whoever brings a parent that has never been to church before will be getting a very, very large prize. It has to do with candy and sugar. And then if your parent has already come, that's okay. We're going to give you 50 points for every parent that's here. So we'll all meet out in the field. Parents, be ready to play an activity and join your child. And we'll try to protect you. We would need you to sign a waiver, so come early for that. And then we'll all meet in here, and we have some cool things here. There's going to be a king from another country that will be making an appearance. I can't tell anything else about that. Also, there'll be five actors from Hollywood, California, that will be making their way across the country and be joining us on that Wednesday. And so look, I just feel sorry for you if you miss that Wednesday. That's July 15th, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday. All right, we're going to take our offering. And so, guys, you can come. And Brother Ben, would you come? Ethan will be playing the offertory for us. I wanted to just let you know about something that God is doing as far as our finances with the church bus. We already have committed a $3,000 gift and a $100 gift. And then a church in Huntsville, Alabama that supports us told us that if we can come up to $3,000 of new gifts, they'll match it up to $3,000. And that's Huntsville Bible Baptist Church. And so that is a great opportunity. And I hope you'll pray about that. This past Wednesday, we picked up kids. We had four vehicles. The van was full. Jonathan's vehicle was full. My wife's vehicle was full. And Hayden's vehicle was full. And so we're really just praying that God would give us a bus to use on Wednesdays and Sundays as well. All right.
Let's pray. Dear God, just thank you for allowing us to worship today. Just pray that you'll continue to bless this church, continue to let it grow, and that all these offerings that are given to you will be used for your ministry. Continue to bless these people day in and day out to further the gospel to this country that needs it very much, and just continue to allow them to worship from their heart with pure worship to bless you. In your name I pray, amen.
the cross of Jesus. Singing. It's still the cross. There's been a lot of songs with that title, but it's still the cross. You gotta prop in your life on the cross. You gotta promise somebody go to the cross. Promise yourself, go to the cross. Forgiveness can be given.
Thank you.
We're going to pray for revival personally and then publicly. And there's a few things that stood out to me, and maybe they did to you, in the song America the Beautiful. It says there, God, mend thine every flaw. We probably have a few flaws in America. The answer is Jesus. The answer is that God would mend our flaws. It also says that God would shed his grace on thee. Don't we need the grace of God in our land? Don't we need the grace of God in our own personal lives? The answer is praying for revival. And there's so many different things that are important. I think leadership is important and the laws are important. But friends, it does come down to what we do with Jesus and what our country will do with Jesus. And so let's pray to that end. I was encouraged about revival this week. There were some teenagers that got together on their own. It wasn't suggested by me. I wasn't at this meeting, but they got together as their idea to pray for revival. And they met at our house and praying specifically for individuals and for our country that needs revival. That they're learning that from somewhere, and I believe they're learning that from the adults in this church that are praying for revival, and the answer is Jesus. And so let's not give up on our country. Let's not give up on our families that we're praying for. Let's not give up on individuals. Let's keep praying that God will get a hold of them. So Hayden's going to play. As he does, would you just personally pray for revival, and then I'll lead us publicly in revival prayer. Lord, we do need you to mend our land. And Lord, we understand the simple truth that it can't happen unless God's people pray. And we do ask that you would pour out your mercy and your grace on our land, on our country. And Lord, our country's made up of individuals that you died for, individuals that need Jesus. And Lord, we know many of them. We work with them. They're in our neighborhoods. We'll meet maybe some of them for the first time even this very day. And so, Lord, I pray that you would give us, as your people, give us a heart for this land and individuals in it that need Jesus. And now, Lord, I pray that you would send revival. Lord, do a powerful work. Lord, would you allow it to spread all across cities in this country and around the world? And Lord, we know that nothing can happen apart from a dependence upon you, and we're asking you to do it. And we can't conjure it up. Lord, we can't fight for it. We've got to depend for it, and we pray for it, and we ask that you would do a powerful work. And so, Lord, would you start right here in our church? Would you allow it to spread to Spartanburg, those that need Jesus, and all across the world? We ask you to do this for your namesake, for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Right after Mr. Hamm sings the special music, the juniors can be dismissed to their class, and then Pastor Bethay will come. This is a special day because it's Independence Day, so we had to have a very special preacher. It just matches. And I was trying to think in my mind this morning how many years ago it was, but it was 21 years ago that Pastor Bethay hired me and took a huge risk in hiring me as his youth pastor, and he's still my pastor. And so I'm so thankful that he could come and preach to us after the special music.
Fighting Sullivans. Only about four and a half people, actually. The five brothers that enlisted in World War II for the United States of America, and they were all killed on the same ship at the same time. Talk about freedom and what it cost. Talk about freedom and what it cost. That's what this is all about. Thank you.
The heart has always known that there is freedom somehow breathed into the very soul of life. The prisoner, the powerless, the slave has always known it. There's something that keeps reaching for the sky. Baby fights for freedom, and songs we love to sing have freedom's theme, and some have walked through fire and flood to find that place of freedom, and some faced hell itself.
Hearts know. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 in your Bibles. Let me turn my cell phone here. I don't know if that worked or not. There you go. Good. Appreciate it. I made a lot of decisions in the last 21 years, some of them good, some of them bad. Just leave it at that. I'll just let you wonder whether hiring you was a good one or a bad one. No, it was one of the best ones that I made, no doubt. It was risky, though. I'm not going to lie. You know, I GPSed it when I got in the parking lot, and we're 11 miles from Cowpens National Battlefield. In January 17th, 1981, if you had been sitting in this church or on this property, you would have heard the cannon fire and the musket fire that was one of the greatest battles of the American Revolution. And because of what happened 11 miles from here, and really probably as much if not more, what happened 34 miles from here just before that battle at Kings Mountain, it was the turning point of the American Revolution. I mean, literally, we are Americans today because of what happened within 35 miles of where you're sitting right now. And that is in and of itself a remarkable privilege to be this close to, I mean, there's a sense in which this is really sacred ground that we live on and worship here and so forth and so on. And you should take advantage of that. If you go to Cowpens, it'll be very unremarkable. I can promise you, you'll go there and you'll go, this is it. There's not a lot there. But if you look into the strategy a little bit of what happened that day, I think you'll be pretty amazed that the Continental Army and literally farmers and hunters and common ordinary people that just lived on this land and wanted to be free men and women, the strategy that they used in a very subtle terrain in order to win that battle, it's a pretty remarkable thing. But anyway, we do live in a unique place, not only America, but in South Carolina and near North Carolina in America as well. And it's a pretty cool thing. On July the 4th, 1821, President Adams said these words, "The highest glory of the American Revolution is this. It connected in one indissoluble bond the principles of," listen to what it connected, all right? Just listen. "The principles of civil government with the principles of Christianity." Now, this country in 2020 has lost its collective mind, folks. I have never stood in church or been in church on a July the 4th celebration when I was more discouraged, disappointed, confused by what is going on in our country today. And there's so many things I wanted to do. I mean, I could keep you here for days doing what I want to do, but I'm going to try to only keep you here for hours instead. So, Patrick Henry, famous for saying what? Firebrand of the Revolution. What are his famous words? Give me liberty or give me death. And usually that's about the only thing that appears in the textbooks today, but let me read the context of those words. Here's what he said. "An appeal to arms and the God of hosts is all that is left us. But we shall not fight our battle alone. There is a just God that presides over the destinies of nations. The battle, sir, is not to the strong alone. Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death." And what I wanted to do this morning was just take a few minutes and talk to you and ask you, first of all, ask you the question, what kind of liberty do you think Patrick Henry had in mind when he said that? What kind of liberty? You know, we use the word liberty and we use the word freedom, but sometimes if you don't think about it a little bit, I mean, sit in a rocking chair and kind of think about it. And this is one of the beautiful things about the preaching ministry is that you know, whatever everybody knows on the surface is never good enough because you aren't giving them anything. So you got to get below the surface. You've got to take the truth And the truth has to wash over you and grow inside of you and take you to another level of understanding of the truth so that you have something to give somebody when they show up on Sunday. It's one of the beauties of the ministry. It's one of the great parts of the ministry is that you cannot afford to be shallow and to be unthoughtful and to be fall asleep at the wheel. So years ago, I thought about freedom and liberty and what it means and the different stages of it. And so today, I wanted to share what I think. These are just my thoughts. That liberty comes in three colors, comes in three versions. Freedom does. And the first one of those versions or colors is human freedom. And in human freedom, I would describe it as this morning. It's when you have whatever you want. If you're incarcerated in prison, you don't have whatever you want. You can't go where you want to go and do what you want to do and be with whoever you want to be with. You're incarcerated. So you don't have human freedom if you've been arrested, if you've been jailed, so to speak. So human freedom is this notion, this concept, this idea that I can do whatever I want to do. It's two-year-old freedom. It's a two-year-old concept. I don't mean 2 years old. I mean what two-year, how, if you ask a two-year-old what freedom is, it's candy for dinner if I want it. If you ask a 15-year-old who recently got his license, what does freedom mean to you? It means I can drive as fast as I want to drive without regard to posted speed laws. Chris is not here today, but I'm here to tell you that you can only do that for so long before your freedom is infringed upon by the law enforcement officers and insurance agents, I know now. And on and on and on it is. So this concept of human freedom, this idea of freedom is I can do whatever I want to do, is the first level of freedom. Human freedom. The freedom to do whatever I want to do. Be whoever I want to be, blah, blah, blah. Well, it's deceptive. Because if you are allowed to do whatever you want to do and be whoever you want to be, you are going to find trouble. You're going to find there are consequences to bad decisions. If the only kind of freedom that you know of this morning, or that you think of this morning, or that you thought was won for you with a lot of bloodshed over the years, then you have a very shallow concept of freedom. It's self-centered. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 10 says this. But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Now, everybody despises government. Okay, but if you look over to the right, you can see that word in its most literal sense means dominion or authority. Does that sound different to you now? They despise authority. In other words, they don't want anybody to tell them what to do. Don't want parents, don't want law enforcement, don't want teachers, don't want bosses. Listen, for as long as you live your life, I don't care who you are or what you do, there's always going to be somebody telling you what to do. Always. And if you despise it, then you fall into this category of your understanding of what freedom is. Presumptuous are they, self-willed. And if you look across, you'll see that means self-pleasing or arrogant. They are not afraid, or they tremble not, to speak evil of dignities. There's no decorum. There's no understanding of how to fix problems that exist in your culture. It's the freedom to do anything you want. No limits, no restrictions, no regard for authority, and it leads to anarchy, and that's what we're seeing today. You know, it's interesting. This movement that's erupted just here recently to tear down all of the monuments and any emblem of anything that represents America's true beginnings. And I just want you to think of one, I just want to think about one thing, right? Think about one thing. By the way, the founders, the people who have monuments erected to them, do you think if you were to ask them today, were you perfect? Do you think they'd say yes? No. They're not perfect men. If you interviewed them at the end of their life and said, hey, would you go back, if you could go back in your life and do things differently, do you think you'd do anything differently than you did 20 years ago? How many of them you think would say, yes, I would do things differently? Come on, gang. Come on. The monuments are not there to represent every decision that everybody's ever made in their life or everything that everybody's ever believed in their life. If that's the case, there ain't going to be no monuments of us. Okay? Because if you want to find something wrong with us, it's there. If you want to find wrong thinking or bad decisions or, boy, wish I hadn't believed what I believed in. I was so small-minded. I was so confused. I was so immature. I just only had so little of the information that I stood for this at this particular time in my life. And what a fool I was in that segment of my life. Too bad, not going to get a monument now. No matter what you do good after that, no monument. No monument for you. I mean, what if everybody that we would honor or everything that someone did that is honorable had as the justification for erecting that monument so that you can remember what it was that was done, required a perfect life? You know how many Bible characters there'd be? Two that I know of. Two. Joseph and Daniel, the only two I know of that would be in the Bible. All the rest of them got to go. Israel's greatest king, Israel's greatest king until Jesus comes back, was an adulterer and a murderer. This our culture has lost its collective mind. There's this groundswell of this movement and this groundswell of this cultural wave that is going on right now is so unthoughtful. And it's really, you know what's interesting about it? It's not at all what it supposedly is about. It's not about racism. And let me take just another short detour and say, God Almighty, the creator of the universe and the one responsible for all of us being here, He did the painting. Okay? I didn't elect to be white. I am whatever God made me. And whatever color you happen to be or anybody happens to be, God Almighty with His divine paintbrush painted that skin color. And for me to say anything contrary or to in any way criticize God because of the color of that skin is to criticize God Himself. But you can't say that in a discussion that would lead to an actual solution. You can't say it because you're a racist if you say that. So what is this really? If it's not about racism, what is it? It's an attack on absolute truth. That's what it is. Nobody wants absolute truth. Everybody wants truth to be their truth. They want to be able to live their lives any way they want to live it. And anybody can do that, by the way. Anyway, you already have that. That human freedom, you got it. But right now, you got a few consequences that go along with it. And what this culture wants today is that human freedom, the ability to do whatever I want to do, but minus the consequences, minus the jail for murder, minus the criticism for morality, minus. They want all of the benefits of self-centered decision-making, but none of the consequences that come along with self-centered decision-making. It is the most confusing moment in time I have ever lived in, and I've lived for like 100 years almost. So, self-centered, and secondly, I want you to notice that human freedom is not only self-centered, that's where it comes from, but it's self-destructive. is self-destructive. Romans chapter 1, verse 18 says it this way. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Proverbs 1, 29 through 32, this passage in particular, I think, points out the destructive nature of self-centeredness. For that they, and if you read the whole, if you read Proverbs chapter 1 beginning with verse 20, you kind of get this thing in context. Where wisdom is personified. Jesus Christ is personified as wisdom in that chapter. So it says, wisdom crieth in the street, other voice in the concourse, so forth and so on. In other words, the picture is that Jesus Christ comes into town and calls out to people and implores people and speaks to people and tries to bring them to an understanding of knowledge and bring them to a place of maturity and true understanding, and they wouldn't listen. And so then it gets down to the end, and this is the penalty for not listening. They hated knowledge. They would not listen to, you know, what was actually true. Their truth was the truth that they made up in their mind, the truth they wanted to be true. And did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would none of my counsel. They despised all of my reproof. Therefore, here's what happens when you do that. Shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices? You know what God's punishment is for not listening to God? He the worst punishment that you could ever endure is that God lets you do what you want to do. Because you know what you'll do? You'll destroy yourself. God doesn't have to punish you. He doesn't have to take you out back and whip you. He doesn't have to take something away from you. If God wants to punish you, all He's got to do is take His hands off of you. That's all He's got to do. All He's got to do is let go and let you have your way and do what you want to do, and you will destruct, you'll destroy yourself. And that's what this passage says. Filled with their own, eat of the fruit of their own way, get what you want, and be filled with your own devices, for the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. If God lets you have what you want, you're in big trouble. The day that you argue against God about what's true and right, the day that you do that to the point to the length of time and for the point that God finally says, all right, you win. Have your parents ever done that? You ever worn your parents down? I want this, I want this, I gotta have this, I can't live without this, and blah, 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 and on and on and on it goes, and finally your parents just say, ay, ay, ay. Okay. Go ahead. And then it was the worst mistake you ever made. They knew something you didn't know. But the day, my friend, the day that you take God Almighty to that point and He says, okay, have at it, big boy. Have your own way. Go ahead. Do it. You can't be happy without it. Go ahead. The day that you do that is the worst day of your life. It is the most destructive day of your life. Proverbs 16, 25 reminds us there's a way that seemeth right unto a man. It seems right. You look at that thing and you turn it every which way and it just seems right, but the end of it is the way of death. It isn't really right. So how do you know? We're in a fix, aren't we? How do you know whether it really is right or not? Well, there's absolute truth. That's how you know. And that's what's under attack. If what's right means what our society says is right, or what's culturally right, or you don't have any right to tell me. I mean, honestly, what could be more simple than boys going to the boys' room and girls going to the girls' room? What could be more simple than that? How complicated is that? It wasn't complicated until a very short while ago. I mean, you just kind of assumed it, didn't you? Nature and whatever. Of all the things I thought we would ever have a conversation about, that never hit the radar. I'm not going to lie. That never occurred to me that we would actually have a discussion that didn't end with a joke about boys going to the boys' room and girls going to the girls' room. Here we are. You know why? Because absolute truth is under attack. That's why. It's not about gender. It's not about race. I mean, not to say that there aren't issues in those areas, okay? Not to dismiss with the wave of a hand things in our culture, in our country that need to be better, need to be addressed, not to do that. But this whole big national movement and problem is smoke and mirrors, if that's what you think it is. The reality is this: you will be judged by God according to your choices. Period. You can decide for yourself that what's right and wrong, and you can make up your own mind as to what's okay and not okay, and what's good and what's bad. You can do that. You're free to do that. But the reality of it is that one day you will be held accountable by God according to this book as to whether or not it actually was or not right or wrong, good, bad. So, I mean, you can deceive yourself. You can lie to yourself. You can fool yourself today if you want to and say, hey, it's okay to, you know, I can't say all that. It's recorded. It's okay to do things that everybody says are okay today that aren't okay. It's okay. I'll just leave it real vague like that. You can say that. You can believe it to your toenails if you want to. But it doesn't change the fact that one day you're going to stand before the Creator of the universe and He's going to say, you're wrong. And I told you. And you ignored it. I came into the streets and you hated knowledge. You would none of my reproof. You ignored me. You blew me off, or you thought you were smarter than what I revealed and gave to you. So now you're going to pay the price. It's going to be a shock. It's going to be and I'm sure there's going to be a lot of arguing going on at that point in time, and a lot of justifying, and a lot of, Lord, you don't understand how things work now in this generation. Well, I think He does. The same way they've worked for all generations, because He's timeless. He was here before the world was created. He'll be here after the world is created, after the world is destroyed, maybe I should say. It's kind of the same day, isn't it? Before it was created and after it was created. 7 days, whatever. Six, if you're being technical. Human freedom is self-centered. It's self-destructive. Secondly, there's another kind of freedom this is the kind of freedom that we generally talk about on July 4th or on a patriotic day. It's national freedom. It's a national kind of freedom. USA. And rather, you know, for this I gave the little tagline for the other, deceive yourself. For this one, I give the tagline, discipline yourself. Because in order to achieve this kind of freedom or this level of freedom, you have to be willing to set a lot of what you want aside, because what's more important to you at the moment is not what you want, but what's good for the country. Every 18-year-old boy that goes down to a recruiter's office and signs a contract to join the military, in a sense, does this. They don't always know, certainly don't know the details of what they're about to get to, but they're going to lay aside some freedoms to do what they want to do. And if they didn't know that before they signed the contract, when they get to boot camp day one, they know it pretty quick. There's a military training officer that's going to make sure that they understand that he's not their mother and they don't get everything they want to get, starting with surrendering the phone. Oh my goodness, you have got to be kidding me. I didn't sign up for giving my phone up. It's a rude awakening for some kids. But they're gonna willfully give up some of their human freedom to stand for something and fight for something and do something that is very, very noble, and we wouldn't be a country without it. And that is to do some things that are good for the country instead of their own freedoms as a human being. It's people-centered or others-oriented kind of freedom. It's a freedom that says, my own personal freedom steps aside when it infringes on the freedom of someone else. I give up my own right to human freedom when the freedom of the country is at stake or the freedom of others is at stake. I set mine aside and I take on a mature, disciplined concept of fighting for, believing in, standing for, working towards a greater good, a greater cause, which is freedom for everyone. So it's an unselfish decision, that kind of freedom, and that's the freedom we're celebrating, because you can believe me that the signers of the Declaration of Independence paid a huge price for signing the Declaration of Independence. Most of them were murdered for it. They pledged their lives, their sacred trust, their fortunes, and most of that was gone. Not only did they pledge it, they ended up giving it as a result. So we're here today. I mean, honestly, all this nonsense is going on all over the country right now at this very moment. The freedom for people to say what they say and burn the flag and do what they do and protest, and all of this is going on was purchased for them. The freedom to do that was purchased for them at great price by noble men whose statues now they want to tear down. These are good citizens. These are good neighbors. These are others-oriented people. There's a freedom to do commonly agreed on things. Yet restriction from commonly agreed on things that might infringe on another's freedom or safety. That's what national freedom is. 1 Corinthians 8:9 says, "But take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak." So, and if you take this national freedom concept and you throw it into the Christian life, it goes, hey, I've got freedom to do this as a Christian, but if you're a weaker brother and I'm going to make you stumble if I do it, I'm going to choose not to do it, even though I'm okay. I'm free to do it. It's okay for me to do it. It's not a problem for me to do it, but for your sake, I'm not going to. That's what it looks like in Christianity, this same kind of an idea. Ronald Reagan said, "Without God, there is no virtue, because there's no prompting of the conscience. Without God, we're mired in the material. That flat world tells us only what senses perceive. Without God, there is a coarsening of the society. And without God," and this is the part I really want you to pay attention to, "democracy will not and cannot long endure if we ever forget that we're one nation. Under God, then we will be a nation gone under." And we're wide open heading in that direction right now. Thirdly, spiritual freedom. Spiritual freedom. There's a human freedom that says, I have the freedom to do whatever I want to do. It's immature. It's foolish. It comes with consequences. It's self-centered and it's self-destructive. There is a national freedom that is noble. That is when someone grows up out of human freedom and sees that that's not the end-all, do-all, have-all, and they say, you know what? Really, what's important is my country more than myself. And they make lots and lots and lots of choices, not just going into the military, but lots of choices that show that maturity that says, I'm not going to take from my government if I don't need from my government. There's 1,000 ways to demonstrate this kind of thing, to give back to your community. And so there's 1,000 ways to show this national kind of freedom that respects everyone's freedom and the health and strength of our nation as a whole, and they set themselves aside in order to accomplish that. There's that. But you can have that high and noble kind of national freedom. You can be an American hero and still miss out on the greatest, most important kind of freedom, which is freedom from sin, spiritual freedom. So we go from totally, completely self-centered, do whatever I want to do, to a disciplining of ourselves to not do certain things for the good of others, to the total and complete death of self, because that's what it requires. Death to self, life in Christ. Now, this is the kind of freedom, gang, that, I mean, you can, without this, none of the other kinds matter. And not every monument that's in America today represents a believer. No question about that. Not all the founders were Christians. They weren't. They had the highest level of national freedom. But not all of them had spiritual freedom. Many of them did, but certainly not all of them did. Self-condemned. What does this spiritual freedom give you freedom from? Well, first and foremost, from the penalty of sin. Romans 6:23 simply says it this way, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." The penalty for sin, the payment for sin, is spiritual death. It's to be cast into the lake that burns eternally with fire with the beast and the false prophet. That's what it is. That's what you get for being a sinner. And you were born one because your ancient parents, Adam and Eve, threw the whole human race into the fall. And as a result of that, our payment, our wages, our just settling before God Almighty is the place the Bible describes as hell. But in Christ, we have freedom from that penalty. Freedom from that penalty. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. Ephesians 5, 8, and 9 says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Spiritual freedom gives you freedom from the penalty of sin. That in and of itself, my friends, is enough to... I mean, if there's any celebrating to be done today, if there are any fireworks to be shot off today, we ought to be more grateful for that freedom than any of the other previous freedoms. But not only that. We don't only get that when we're in Christ. We don't only get freedom from penalty of sin down the road when we stand before God and judge, but we also get freedom from the very presence of sin today. I'm sorry, from the power of sin today. In other words, sin no longer has dominion over you. It doesn't rule you anymore. The devil is no longer your landlord. If he is, when he comes to demand rent, you don't have to pay. It's the only time that happens. Romans 6:19 says, "Speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh, for as you have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness." You were in bondage, in slavery to sin and the devil previously, but now that you have been set free, now that you are at liberty, these are our words, you don't have to do that anymore. You can now yield yourself to righteousness, to cleanness. Chapter 8, verses 1 through 13, this is not all the verses, but it says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made them free from the law of sin and death." What? These are remarkable, wonderful words that should be celebrated today. We're no longer condemned. We're no longer under. The law of Christ is ruling and reigning over the law of righteousness. The law that we are not capable of keeping. We can't be good enough to be led into God's heaven. The law doesn't allow it. The strict law, we're all guilty, we're all condemned. But the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has made us free from the law of sin and death. It is worthy, my friends, of celebration today. If you want to shoot off some fireworks, shoot them off for that. What the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. There you go, that's what we want. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. We don't have to. We don't owe the flesh a debt. For if we live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you live through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. Romans 13:14 says, "Put you on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." 2 Corinthians 7:1, "Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Galatians 2:20 became my life verse a few years ago. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. There's spiritual freedom. It's death to self. There's freedom from the penalty of sin. There's freedom from the power of sin to rule and to reign in our hearts and minds, to demand us to do things that we in our spiritual heart don't want to do. It's the tug of war. There's victory and the rope that the Spirit of God is anchored to pulls and wins the tug of war every time if allowed to do so. There's also freedom from the very presence of sin. That's coming. It's not here yet, but that's coming. 1 Corinthians 15:50 says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. You get the point there. Hebrews 2:14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had power over death, that is the devil. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, and here it is, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Three kinds of freedom to think about this morning. Three kinds of freedom. Human freedom. This notion, this idea that I want the freedom or I have the freedom to do whatever I want. Boy, what a childish, immature, self-destructive way to think. There is a national freedom that's noble, that puts the good of the country ahead of self. And for many, many years after this country was founded, we progressed along the road of national freedom. I think, it's my own opinion, I think it was the 50s, 1950s, 60s, 70s, where the real decline became. But at some point, we stopped going down that road as a nation. And we paused and we thought about things for a minute and we let human freedom really infect our minds as a nation and as a culture, and we started to take back that childish, immature vision of freedom, and it became more about human freedom in the free love and drugs and generation and liberality and so forth and so on, began to become more self-focused and less country-focused. And at some point, we turned around and we started going the wrong way. And as a nation, we started heading more and more back away from what's good for the country into this idea of individuals in the country asking, what's good for me? And in the recent months, weeks, years, we are at a full sprint in that direction. I don't know where we're going to end up. Oh, well, I mean, I do. We're headed as fast as we can towards the tribulation period, which I believe the rapture of the church happens before that. I believe that. If it doesn't, I'll be a mid-trib. And then if it doesn't, I'll be post-trib, pre-millennial. I'm going to keep going early as I can for as long as I can. But, I mean, the pieces are in place for tribulation period. Pieces are in place. Globalism, cashless society, breakdown authority so that we think culturally instead of with absolute truth. It's all there. It's all in place. And then you think about this. Christians have become so ineffective anyway of influencing our country and its thought. But take all of them away and think about what's left, and how fast do you think we get into a tribulation period after that happens? There is no influence of the Spirit, nothing to slow anything down, nothing to get in the way of the beast and the false prophet doing what they do. So, I mean, gang, I know this message has been a lot of different directions, but we're there. I thought about this. At the very end, just thinking about this message and these truths and this time of year and all these things, I thought about those men, those ancient men, sitting around in a room one day discussing the need to declare independence from Great Britain and formulating this document, stating it, and then signing it. And it occurred to me that with the stroke of a pen, colonists became Americans. With the stroke of a pen. Now, a lot happened. Actually, it was ratified on August the 2nd, July 4th, but on August the 3rd, you can believe that Britain didn't like that and war ensued and so forth and so on. But literally, with the stroke of the pen, this nation became a nation and became free from Great Britain. Now, there was still a battle to win from that, but with the stroke of a pen. And I thought, you know, I went back to when I was 12 years old and I bowed my knee at an old-fashioned altar and I thought with a prayer of repentance, I became a Christian. Been a lot of battles since then. Devil has given me a lot of trouble since that day. But with the signing of a name, a nation became a nation and became independent of a tyrant. And as a 12-year-old boy, I responded to an invitation and bowed my knee at an old-fashioned altar and asked Jesus to come into my heart. And with a prayer of repentance, I was free from the penalty and the power of sin. With a prayer. With a faith transaction. With a realization that I can't get myself to heaven. I can't. I can't do anything about my condition. It's bad. It's terminal. But all I need to do is admit my sin and ask Jesus Christ to save my soul, and with a transaction of faith, I became a child of God. I was adopted into God's family, became a child of God, and my sins were forgiven, past, present, and future. And not only was I saved from the penalty of sin and the power of sin in my life, but I look forward to that day when I'll be clean of the very presence of it. Life's filled with paradoxes, filled with them. Perhaps the most important one of all is that we must abandon ourselves, we must die to ourselves in order to live. It's a paradox. Full freedom comes with full surrender. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says simply, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. You want real freedom? You want real freedom? I mean freedom. The kind of freedom that I think that many of the founders intended beyond national freedom, even. Certainly Patrick Henry embraced God as Jehovah God. Well, that freedom, that liberty only comes when the Spirit of the Lord is welcome. Did you realize that? That you know, if you don't want the Lord around, He won't be around. Do you realize that? If you don't want Him in your life, He won't be in your life. If you don't want Him to bother you, He won't. He's only going to be present when He's welcome. But when He is welcome and when He is present, there is liberty. Whether you're in jail or not. You can incarcerate a believer, in Philippians, the Paul and Silas, thrown into the innermost part of the prison in bonds and stocks, beaten, and yet singing to God, singing to the Lord. Free, the most free men in the area, the most free men in town were locked in a prison. Because the Spirit of the Lord was there. Philippian jailer said he wanted some of that. Heard that kind of singing. I'm going to leave you with one last thought. It's a little off the beaten path, but I think that Christians are not blameless in our country being where it is. I think we've fallen asleep at the wheel for generations. Mine included. In 1876, at a congressman, chairing the Appropriations Committee, James Garfield said this, if the next century does not find us a great nation, it will be because those who represent the morality of the nation do not aid in controlling the political forces. In other words, those of us who believe the truth if we are not involved with, if we are not influencing the political direction, then we won't be a great nation, and that's why. And I think Christians in America over the last decades have allowed much of what we see today to happen in front of us, and we should be ashamed of ourselves for it. And I certainly hope that in the coming days we will do all that we can. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your love and mercy and grace and goodness to us. I pray that we might find ourselves spiritually free today, that we might have moved past human freedom, foolish, destructive, and that we might share as a church and as citizens of a great country, a country that was founded on the authority of Scripture, that we might find ourselves reveling in and celebrating our national freedom today. But beyond that, Lord, I pray that if there's anyone here this morning who does not know spiritual freedom, freedom from penalty of sin, power of sin, presence of sin, that even today you might speak to that heart, convict them of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Bring them to a place, Lord, where they're ready to make that transaction of faith, for with the prayer of repentance, one can pass from death unto life. And with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, could I just ask that question this morning while our heads are bowed before the Lord? Is there someone here who would say, I want to be spiritually free? Is there someone here who would say, I'm not sure that I'd die if I died right now and go to heaven to be with the Lord, but you can pray for me as you conclude. That's all I'm going to do. I'm not going to embarrass you, point you out, ask you to do anything that makes you uncomfortable. I would like to include you in my very final prayer. Just show me your hand, put it right back down, I'll acknowledge it. Anyone here who would say, pray for me, I'm not 100% sure that if I died today, I'd go to heaven, but I want you to pray for me. Would you hold it up real quick, up real high so I can see it, right back down, okay. All right, thank you. All right. Father, thank you for your love for us and goodness to us, your grace. Thank you for the nation that you've given to us. Forgive us where we have failed to influence it the way we should. Help us take a stand for right and truth and the absolute truth of Scripture. Help us, Lord, to be good Christians and good Americans. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's keep our heads bowed and eyes closed just for a second. I'm going to ask Hayden to play. Whatever God has spoken to your heart about, would you just be obedient to the Lord? It might be something that you need to pray about as it relates to gratitude or maybe authority. Or maybe just being bold for the truth. If you're not saved, we would love to take a Bible and show you how you can be sure that you're saved. Maybe you need to turn to a parent or come to the front here, and we'd be happy to take a Bible and help you. Let's just talk to God about whatever He talked to us about. Lord, thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the message that we heard this morning. And Lord, would you stir our hearts, constantly stir our hearts with these truths that we heard this morning. Lord, help us to be bold for truth wherever we are, in the right way, in a loving way, but to do our part. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to be the right kind of Christian in our environment. And Lord, we're here in Spartanburg, and I pray, Lord, that we would be light in this dark place. And to thank you again for the word of God this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would bless the Bethays. We pray for Hudson. Pray that you would continue to work in his heart, in his life, spiritually and physically, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would heal him. And Lord, bless this family. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our afternoon service.